For this video, we dive into a little bit more detail in how we predict the relative pH of salt solutions. And we'll discuss two methods for predicting this. And if you're asked to predict, either method works. You don't need to justify necessarily, but I will present both methods. So again, we're going to work with the salt solutions that we predicted in our previous video. These are the products of our acid-base reactions. With one small change, realize that this formula in our previous video, I actually predicted it as the nitrate instead of bromide. It doesn't really matter for reasons that we'll discuss when we get to that salt. So just realize that that formula is slightly different. So again, there are two ways that we can label or predict pHs of salts. And so when I say label, I mean that, again, you want to try to identify the type of solution. So before we did strong acid, strong base, weak acid, weak base. Now when we're working with salts, we want to know if this salt or each salt is acidic, basic, or neutral. And so we can do that by identifying the combination of acid and base that made the salt, or we can label each ion based on its behavior in water. So we're going to look at sodium chloride as our first example. And in our first method, we want to determine the acid and base that give us sodium chloride. Remember that cations come from bases. And so to figure out that formula, I'm going to add the hydroxide onto sodium. To figure out the acid that gave me chloride, I'm going to tack a hydrogen on the front, and obviously enough hydrogens to balance the charge. Realize that all of our anions are going to be a minus one charge. And so we tack the hydrogen on there. Of course, to finish balancing this equation, it does form water, but our goal is to figure out the strength of the acid and base that made this salt. So we should be able to quickly recognize that we combined a strong acid with a strong base. That gives us a neutral salt overall, where we predict a pH of 7. Now, the second method we can use to predict or label this salt, to predict the pH or label this salt, is to look at the ions that comprise this salt. So of course, as this dissociates, it does so into a sodium ion and a chloride ion. And now I can look at the nature of each of my ions in here to identify if these are acidic, basic, or neutral. What I need to recognize is that sodium is one of the cations in my strong bases, right, as we see up here, and therefore sodium is a neutral cation. Again, it is one of the cations in my list of strong bases, so it is a neutral cation. For chloride, we do the same justification. It is an anion from a strong acid, and therefore it is a neutral anion. Since both of my ions are neutral, this gives us a neutral salt with a pH of 7. All right, so let's move on to our second example, working with potassium fluoride. Now notice that we are going to have some hydrolysis, and we want to be able to label our anions. So I'm going to go through the same two methods, where we can identify the acid and base that made the salt, or we can label each ion. To figure out the base that gave me potassium, I add hydroxide onto the end of it. To figure out the acid that gave me fluoride, I add a hydrogen onto the front of that. So notice potassium hydroxide is a strong base, hydrofluoric acid is a weak acid, and we're not worried about it here, but to balance this equation, we do form water. Since I combined a strong base with a weak acid, this will give me a basic salt, where we predict the pH to be greater than 7. For our second method, we start by breaking this salt apart into its component ions, otherwise known as dissociation. Right, we're just dissociating this ion or this salt into its ions. And so now I label my ions based on what they're going to do in water. Well, the potassium ion we know comes from a strong base, again, as we saw up in number one. So this is going to be neutral. Fluoride, however, does not come from a strong acid. This is the conjugate base of a weak acid. And since this is the conjugate base of a weak acid, this ion, fluoride, will be a basic. That is horrible handwriting. Sorry. This will be a basic anion. So we have a neutral and a basic ion combined together. That overall will give us a basic salt, where we predict the pH to be greater than 7. And a little bit follow up here, I'm going to erase my notes under fluoride just so I have more space to write this. So let's say we couldn't tell or couldn't predict what fluoride was going to do. We didn't know if it was going to be basic. We know that potassium is neutral, meaning that it will not hydrolyze. There's no further reaction with potassium. But I want to see what fluoride is going to do in water. And we've already seen this reaction and this equation, but let's say we have a different example that we want to work through and figure out. So fluoride in water, again, fluoride is the conjugate base of a weak acid, meaning that it will also set up equilibrium. And here we just have a simple acid-base reaction. So the proton from water will transfer to hydrogen. We reform hydrofluoric acid. And my conjugate base of water is going to be the hydroxide ion. So this equation that I've written here is my hydrolysis equation. This is the reaction with water. Notice that as fluoride reacts, I do produce hydroxide. Because we produce hydroxide, that verifies that fluoride is acting as a base in solution. And so we do know that that is a basic anion. Notice that our reaction still balances here for the hydrolysis equation. Atoms balance and our charge balances. I have a net minus one charge on the reactant side, and I have a net minus one charge on the product side. And so the labels that are possible for anions, of course, they can be neutral, right? There's 7 of those that come from our strong acids, or as we saw with fluoride, they can be basic. And there are a lot of those. We won't list a number here. Realize that anions can never be acidic. They will never react in order to produce hydronium. So the only two labels for anions are neutral and basic. For our next discussion, we'll look at ammonium bromide. Again, remember in the original slide when we were predicting products, I used ammonium nitrate, but we'll talk about the fact that that one doesn't matter. So again, looking at our two possible options, we're going to make ammonium bromide. And we do that, our cation comes from the base. The base that gives us ammonium has to be ammonia. So this one, we're not tacking the hydroxide onto the end of it. I technically could, but I have to recognize that ammonium hydroxide is equivalent to ammonia. These do the same thing in water. They become the same thing. So ammonia is my weak base that gave me the ammonium ion. And then of course, bromide came from hydrobromic acid. So here we see, of course, that ammonia is a weak base. Hydrobromic acid is a strong acid. This gives us an acidic salt where we predict our pH to be less than 7. So realize bromide could be interchanged with nitric acid. All right, those are both strong acids. They both have the same charge. And so that's why it doesn't matter which anion I used in here, because both of them are neutral. in our second option for labeling, we start with our salt. We dissociate it into its ions correctly. That's going to be an NH4 plus. And we produce bromide ion. So now in this method, we are labeling our ions. Bromide we recognize as being neutral because it comes from a strong acid. Ammonium we know is the conjugate acid of a weak base, so it will be acidic. But again, let's say we don't know that it's acidic, and let's write our hydrolysis equation for that one. Again, hydrolysis simply means reacting in water. This is going to set up equilibrium because I don't have a strong reactant here. And so ammonium is going to act as the acid. It's going to donate a proton to water. That means that we end up getting hydronium in solution. And again, we check to make sure our equation balances, atoms balance, and our charges balance. So notice we start with a net plus one on the reactant side. We get a net plus one on the product side. So in other words, if I start with a plus one charge on the reactant side, I have to produce hydronium. If I were to start with a negative charge on the reactant side, I would have to produce hydroxide. And so that's a shortcut way to figure out what you should be producing in this reaction, whether hydronium or hydroxide. So going back up to our main question at the top here, we want to know what labels are possible for cations. So of course, cations can be neutral, are eight cations that come from strong bases, or cations can be acidic. So again, there are numerous of these. The main one that we'll use, it's by far not the only one that you should recognize, but the most common one you should recognize is the ammonium ion. The last slide that we have in this video is a summary slide of the two methods you can use to predict the relative pH of a salt. You can look at the acid and base that gave that salt, or you can label the cation and anion. And again, the labels for cations and anions are down here. So recognize in here, what we are not going to cover is the combination of a weak acid with a weak base. I will not provide that one to you. I'll cover it in a couple of slides or a couple of videos, but I won't ever ask a question about that one. And I just realized one other side comment I wanted to make, going back to our very first video or slide on the salt solutions, was to cover the arrows that we're using in here. So recognize that our first three reactions have completion arrows, and that's because we are working with at least one reactant that is strong. So in these first three, we have a strong acid, a strong base, or both. As long as we have one reactant that is strong, that's going to force each of these reactions to go to completion. It's only in the case where we have two weak substances that our reaction sets up equilibrium. So that will be very important going forward into chapter 15 and later on in our calculations in chapter 14.